All right, so make sure you download our new app so you can stay in touch with everything that's going on here at Destiny and not miss anything. And again, that's also how we are going to be giving. So if you are giving through our app, again, the old app is going away. So if you want to stay in touch giving financially online, you'll want to switch over to the new app. Awesome. Go ahead and open up your Bibles this morning to 2 Corinthians. We are going to begin in 2 Corinthians today, 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 weeks ago, I started a new message called In God We Trust, and I planned on that kind of just being a one-off message. Didn't really plan on this turning into a mini-series, but I wanted to stay on that theme about trusting God. And so today I'm calling this In God We Trust, part two. Part two. How many of you know it's one thing to say In God We Trust, but it's another thing entirely to actually put all your trust in God? It's easy to say we trust in God, but when life gets hard, and we all know life gets hard, life is not always easy. We go through seasons. We go through some seasons where everything's going great. Everything's going well. It's like yes, I'm experiencing God's blessings and favor on my life, and it just seems like everything's great. And then there are seasons where you go through difficulties and you go through challenges, and it's hard in those times to keep all your trust in God. Can I be real? Right? It's real life. And so in part one, we looked at Peter. We looked at Peter in part one and the disciples who had been out all night fishing. They had gone out all night, pulled an all-nighter, didn't catch a single fish. Later that morning, that same morning after being out all night, they're very frustrated. They're very frustrated. They're probably discouraged, feeling like, you know, we were out all night, didn't catch a single thing. This is how we make our living. How are we going to provide for our families? How are we going to, you know, all that stuff. And so Jesus tells Peter, after he got on the boat and went and preached a little bit, he asks Peter, he says, "Hey, Peter, I know you were out all night, didn't catch a thing, but you know what? I think you should try one more time. Take your boat out, go out one more time." Peter's probably thinking, you know what? We already did that. We were out all night. Already did that. Already tried it. Didn't work. But at your word, because you say so, if you say so, we'll go out. So Peter and the disciples, they go back out after being out all night, very frustrating. They go back out and they catch the largest fish, the largest load they had ever caught. Not only did they fill up their boat, they filled up another boat. They filled two boats of fish. Come on, this is thousands of fish we're talking about. So much fish that the boats began to sink. Now, I don't know about you. I've been out on some fishing boats. I'm always surprised at how many people you can get on a boat and all that weight, and it still floats. So I can't imagine how much fish had to be on that boat for the boat to begin to sink. But two boats began to sink because of how many fish they caught, because they were obedient to Jesus. How many of you know when you obey Jesus, blessings follow? When you're obedient to Jesus, when you obey his word is truth. When you obey his word, blessings and favor will follow your life. Amen? So even with that giant catch, even with that giant load of fish that they catch, you know what they end up doing? They left it all. They left it all to follow Jesus. That giant blessing they had just experienced, they had just caught, they left it all to follow after Jesus. Today, I want to look at another man in the Bible who many times had to trust in God to get him through some hard times, some hard, difficult situations. Many people are facing hard times right now in this economy, having a hard time putting gas in their car, having a hard time putting food on the table. And times are hard right now. Economically, families are hurting. Families are feeling the financial pressure and the financial stress of our times and where we're at as a country right now. It can be hard to put all your trust in God when it seems like things are getting worse, right? It can just be hard. It can be hard to put all your trust in God. We know we trust in God. We say we trust in God. But when it comes down to it, oftentimes, sometimes when things get rough, when things get hard, it can be hard to put all your trust in God. Am I the only one? I mean, I know I'm your pastor, but even I have times where it's like, man, it is just so hard right now to put all my trust in God. And so here's what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Look at verse 6. We're going to begin in verse 6. Paul says this, "If I wanted to boast, I would be no fool in doing so because I would be telling the truth. But I won't do it because I don't want anyone to give me credit beyond what they can see in my life or hear in my message, even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God. So to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from becoming proud. 3 different times I begged the Lord to take it away. Each time, the Lord said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. My power works best in weakness." Come on. God's power works best in your weakness. He goes on to say, "So now I'm glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. For when I am weak, then I am strong." Turn to your neighbor and tell him, "I am weak, but he is strong. I'm weak, but he's strong." One of the lies that Satan wants us to believe is the lie that we have to be strong all on our own. That you have to be strong. You have to be strong. That we have to be strong and independent. That we don't need God. We don't need the church. We don't need the Bible. I got this. I can handle this. I'm a strong person. That's a lie that the devil wants you to believe. Is that you are strong enough to handle these things on your own. You don't need the body of Christ. You don't need anybody. You don't need the church. You don't need to read your Bible. You don't need to spend time in prayer. You don't need to pray about it. You don't need to lift your hands in worship and surrender your things to God. This is what the enemy wants to convince you of. What is the devil's greatest weapon? Well, Jesus talks about this in John chapter 8, verse 44. You want to turn your Bibles to John 8, 44. It says this, when he lies, Jesus is speaking about the devil. He says, when he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. What is the devil? He is a liar, right? The devil is a liar. The devil is not just a liar, he is the father of lies. He invented lying. You realize that the devil was the first one to ever tell a lie. He invented lying. It's his native tongue. It's his native language. What language do you speak? English, Spanish, French. What language does Satan speak? Lies. That's his language. When you tell a lie, you are speaking the language of Satan. When you tell a lie, you are actually speaking Satan's language. You're essentially allowing Satan to speak through you. I taught this to my kids. Rylan's sitting right over here in the second row. And I taught him, listen, bud, when you tell a lie, you're speaking the devil's language. We don't want to speak the devil's language, do we? We don't want to speak the devil's language. And so we don't want to tell lies, because when we tell lies, we are speaking the same language the devil speaks. The devil speaks lies. But if the language of the devil is lies, what would be the language of God? Truth. Truth is God's language. So I've taught my kids, when we tell the truth, we're speaking God's language. But when we tell lies, we're speaking the devil's language. Parents, teach your kids this. Teach your kids this. Teach your kids to tell the truth, that when you tell the truth, you're speaking God's language. But when you tell lies, you're speaking the language of Satan. Jesus gives us the answer for the lies. In John chapter 8, verse 32, Jesus said, "They will know the truth." And what will the truth do? It will set you free. Jesus said, "They will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." The truth will set you free. Satan wants you to believe the lie that you have to be strong all on your own, that you can handle this, you can do it. Jesus, though, wants to reveal the truth. And when you experience the truth will set you free. How many of you want to be free today? The truth will set you free. There's nothing wrong with being strong, okay? There's nothing wrong with being strong. We want to be strong. We want to be strong spiritually. We want to be strong spiritually. We want to be strong emotionally, psychologically, right? There's nothing wrong with being strong. We should be exercising our spiritual muscles. We should be working on personal development so that we can be better in all areas of our life. Can I get an amen? Okay, so there's nothing wrong with that. But here's why Satan wants you to think that you have to be strong all on your own. Do you want to know why Satan wants to convince you that you have to be strong all on your own? Can I tell you why? Here's why, and I want you to write this down. If Satan can convince you to rely on your own strength will prevent you from depending on God. Come on. Satan wants to convince you that you're strong enough, because if Satan can convince you to just rely on your own strength will prevent you from depending on God. It will prevent you from depending on Him. I don't need to pray, I got this. I don't need to pray about it, I got this. I don't need to read my Bible, I got this. I don't need to go to church, I got this. Until eventually you say, "I don't need God, I got this." Come on. That's pride. That's self-sufficiency. You know, we're not created to be self-sufficient. We were created to be God-sufficient. We were created to rely and depend on God. And the moment that you think you don't need Him, that's when all of a sudden things happen that are going to force you to rely and depend on God. We're not created to be self-sufficient. We're created to be God-sufficient. Not self-reliant, but God-reliant. Not self-dependent, but God-dependent. Come on, church. The bottom line is, no matter how strong you think you are, and you can write this down, your strength is limited. No matter how strong you think you are, and you may be very strong. You may be very strong spiritually. You may be born and raised in the church, attending every Bible study, reading your Bible every day, praying every day. But no matter how strong you think you are, your strength is limited. Your strength does run out. Eventually, it runs out. Listen, you are not created by God to have the ability to do just anything and everything in your own strength. Let me say that again. You were not created to do just anything and everything that you want to do. Do you understand what I'm saying? You were not created to do just anything and everything in your own strength. In fact, there are some things that will require you to depend on God's strength and ability. God will call you to do something that you will not be able to accomplish by your own strength. It will require you to depend on God. If you're going to achieve what it is that God's called you to do, it will require you to rely and lean on God. It's intentional. Your strength is intentionally limited. But here's the good news. God's strength is unlimited. Come on, somebody. God's strength is unlimited. God's strength is not limited. That's why God wants us to not trust in our own limited abilities, but rather to do life empowered by his unlimited power by trusting him. Trusting him. In God we trust. God wants us dependent on him, not independent from him. Let me say that again. God wants us dependent on him, not independent from him. God wants you depending on him, not independent from him. Many of us are trying to do life on our own limited strength, and we're frustrated, and we're feeling worn out. There's limited human strength, but there's unlimited supernatural strength from God. As believers, we don't just operate in the natural as the world does. Our faith gives us access to the supernatural, unlimited power of God. That is what your faith gives you access to. Your faith gives you access to the unlimited supernatural power of God living and breathing in your life. I want to read Isaiah chapter 40, verse 30 through 31. Isaiah, prophet Isaiah, writes this in chapter 40, verses 30 through 31. It says, even youths will become weak and tired, and young men will fall in exhaustion. But those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. Those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. What is that new strength? That new strength is his strength. Your strength runs out. Your strength is limited. But those who put their trust in God find new strength. Where does that new strength come from? Come on, church, where does that strength come from? It comes from God. When you put your faith and your trust in God we trust, God gives you strength. God will give you supernatural strength. It's not your own strength. It's his strength. It's not your own power. It's his power. It says they will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. This is the kind of strength that I want. I don't want to rely on my own physical strength. I want to rely and depend on God's strength. I want to depend and rely on the Lord to carry me through. Going back now to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. We read here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul had something or someone that was driving him crazy. It was bugging the snot out of him. And we don't know. The Bible doesn't explicitly tell us what exactly it was. We don't know if it was something physical, like an ailment. A lot of theologians believe that he had bad eyes. We don't know if it was a person. I tend to kind of believe it might have been a person because it says it was a messenger from Satan. And I know I've received some messengers from Satan in my life as a pastor. At least I think I have. I don't know. But some people, you know. That is a thorn in my flesh. Lord, take it. Take it away, God. Take it away. Whatever it was, Paul begged God to take it away. Take it away. Three times. Now, we know Paul has experienced the miraculous healing of God. We know Paul has witnessed blind eyes opened. Paul has witnessed people who cannot walk getting up and walking. Paul believes in the power of God. Paul knows about the supernatural power of God. If anyone has witnessed the miraculous power of God, it's Paul. Right? Are you with me? Paul knows what God is capable of. Paul knows that God can and God could, but he didn't. You have to understand this. Paul knows that God can, that God could, but he didn't. Three times he asked God, he begged God, please take it away. Please take it away. Please take it away. And for some higher purpose. His ways are higher than our ways. His purpose is higher than our purpose. We don't always understand why God does what he does or why he doesn't do what we want him to do. But we have to continue to trust in him. We have to continue to trust his plan. And so for some higher purpose, God left it there. God did not take it away. And in his desperation, as Paul's crying out to God, God spoke to Paul and said this. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So Paul says, I'm glad now to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. When we're weak, he's strong. When you're weak, he's strong. When you feel weak, his strength works best in your weakness. But there's only one way it does that. If you will depend and rely on him. If you will trust in him. He says, I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and hardships and persecutions and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. When I'm weak, then I'm strong. Because God's power rests on me. God's power works best in my weakness. You can write this down. The truth is, God's power works best in your weakness. We're talking today about strength and weakness, power and weakness, how God will use your weaknesses for your greater good. God will use your weaknesses to accomplish his plan in your life. It's when we feel weak that we are forced to depend on God. When we are weak, he gives us strength. God said that his power works best in our weakness. Come on. So if you're feeling weak today, I've got good news for you. God's power works best when you feel weak. God's power is ready to go to work in your life when you feel weak. His power doesn't just work fine. His power doesn't just work enough. His power actually works best. Somebody say best. His power works not just good. It works best in your weaknesses. It works best when we are weak. Grab a hold of that, somebody. And guess what? His strength and his power is unlimited. The Apostle Paul, he learned this, and we see the lesson that God was teaching him, that when we are weak, he is strong. And he went on to say, so now I'm glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, somebody say, when I'm weak, he is strong. His power works best in your weakness. This is the one thing I want to drill home in your heads today. That when you feel weak, that's when his power works best. It's actually an advantage when you feel weak. Again, you know why? Because what we should do, our only reasonable response when we feel weak is to go to God and depend on God and rely on God and cry out to God and say, God, I need you. I need your power to work in my life right now because I can't do this on my own. I can't get through my own. My own gifts and my own abilities and my own strength will not get me through this. I need your supernatural strength to get me through this. And when you have a heart that cries out to God in desperation, that is when his power comes out, and that's when his power works best in your life. Come on. I can have the team come up and help me close. We're going to close here in just a few minutes. You do not have the strength. You do not have the strength to do what you're trying to do right now. You don't have the strength for your busy schedule. You don't have the strength to hold your marriage together. Some of you, your marriages are going through some challenges right now. And let me just encourage you and tell you that you may not have the strength to get through it on your own. Your strength is limited, but God's strength is unlimited, and his strength and his power works best in our weakness. You can't always do it, but he can. You can't, but he can. His power works best in your weakness. You were not created to do it on your own. You were not created to have the ability to do everything you want to do by your own strength. If you are going to accomplish God's will for your life, I can promise you right now, God's will for your life will require you to depend on him. At some point, it will require you to fully put your faith and your trust in him to get you through. You are not created to do it on your own. You have to trust God, rely on God, depend on God. When you are dependent on God, and when you're weak, and when you're broken before him, his power works best. When you come before God weak and broken, man, God loves, that is what God lives for, is to heal the brokenhearted and to set the captives free. He loves to go to work in the lives of those who are weak and broken so that you can witness the supernatural power of God at work in your life. You have no other explanation than to say, without God, I wasn't going to get through this, but God. I wasn't going to make it through, but God. Philippians 4:13, we all know this. Very popular verse to memorize. Also a very commonly misunderstood verse, taken out of context. Philippians 4:13, we all know it. For I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Other translations say I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. What you have to understand is Paul wrote this verse while sitting in prison. Paul writes, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And he writes it while sitting in prison. You know what this verse is not saying? This verse is not saying that whatever you set your mind to, you can do it. Because if that's what it was saying, Paul would not have been sitting in prison. Paul would have been a free man. What Paul is actually saying is, I can get through everything. I can get through all things through Christ who gives me strength. I'm going through a hard time right now. I'm sitting in prison and I don't like it. I'd rather be out in the free world. I'm sitting in prison for preaching the good news. And I'm sitting in prison, but you know what? When I'm weak, he's strong. I'm sitting in prison, but I can get through this. I will get through this through Christ who gives me strength. That is the real meaning of Philippians 4:13, that no matter what you face, no matter what challenges you face, because challenges will come, life will get hard, but God will get you through. You can get through it through Christ who gives you strength. That's good news, church. No matter what you face, you can and you will get through it if you rely on Christ. Don't depend on your own strength. You depend on his strength. Are you getting this? There is strength in weakness. There are those of you who are going through a challenge right now. Maybe a crisis, maybe a difficult season, and you can't handle it, but God can. You can't handle it, but the good news is you are not created to handle it on your own. You were not created to get through all these hard situations on your own. And you are now desperate for God. God has you right where he wants you. You might be going through a hard time right now, but it's in those hard times that we often cry out to God. It's in those crises that we often cry out for God, because we are at the end of our rope. We have nowhere else to turn but to rely on God. And I hate to make it sound like we use God as a last resort, because God should never be a last resort. But God often comes through for those who use him as a last resort, because he is faithful even when we're not. Even when we're not. Even when it's the only time he ever hears us call out his name is when we have no other option. He should not be our last option. But he is faithful. He is faithful, and in our weakness and in our brokenness and in our desperation, when we cry out to God, he is faithful, and his power goes to work for you in your weakness. And so now you're desperate for God, and he's waiting. He's ready to make his unlimited strength, his unlimited power, exactly what you need for this moment.
We want to give you the opportunity to accept Jesus into your heart as your Lord and Savior. If you want to make that choice and have that assurance that you're saved and going to heaven, repeat this prayer after me. Father God, thank you for sending your Son Jesus to be the perfect and final sacrifice for all of my sins. Today I choose to live for you. Forgive me of my sins. Make me righteous. I confess you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
If you said that prayer for the first time, we'd love to send you a free gift all about your choice to follow Jesus. Simply email us at the link below with your email address.
It's time now to give in our tithes and offerings. We want to thank you for your continued faithfulness in your giving. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9 verse 10 that God provides seed to the sower. Keep sowing that seed and God will keep providing seed to sow.
There are four ways that you can give. You can give online through our website, you can give through texting on your phone, you can give through our Destiny app and set it up to be automated, and you can give by mail. Thanks again for your generosity. We pray that God bless it and multiply it. In Jesus' name, amen.